Basically, it will be reflecting more of what we had already discussed since morning, the nature of, it's not a pure PPP model that's in that way, water users associations. It's a state, non-state actors mostly. But I think most of the issues that we have been talking about since morning, the failure of the state, the really critically looking at the very idea of the failure of the state in itself, as well as the power nexus, the state bureaucracy, and the emerging market. So,
this is moving.
So basically, I built up my presentation mostly from the concept note that we've been circulated among us. I think that the concept note raises four important questions, and I tried to narrow down those four important questions in four different issues that I will be addressing through my presentation. Then I will be talking about more about my research in terms of the topic. It was part of my PhD work, so in terms of my research site and my approach. Then I will be elaborating those issues that I already stated in my observations in terms of how do they manage. And finally, I will be giving a conclusion of overall this presentation. So these four questions that have been circulated already in our concept note really are quite interesting because they talk more about the kind of debates that we all have been dealing with, the trade-off that is involved between efficiency and equitable distribution, the kind of role that the state has been into this whole process of PPPs, whether we need to revisit the role of the state in itself, what is private, what is public, that sort of a debates. And I have tried to narrow it down into four different issues that I will be addressing through my own PhD work. And those are like equitable and efficiency debate in terms of who actually pays the cost for this equitable efficiency debate, or is really that sort of a balance is there being achieved by these education reforms that I'm going to talk about. Then I'm going to speak about institutional aspects in terms of how institutions being introduced in this particular context functions in terms of their formation as well as their functioning, and how they are socially embedded in a particular context, and how they reproduce the kind of hierarchies that we talk about. Then we'll be moving around to talk about the role of non-government organization, and I think this was not mentioned in our concept work, but I think it's an important issue that needs to be understood in terms of when we're talking about the role of the state itself. So basically my PhD work was on Maharashtra's management of education sector, Maharashtra's education sector reforms carried out in 2005. So we had this one act called as Maharashtra Management of Irrigation System, the Farmers Act, which was basically pro in terms of establishment of water users associations. And the very kind of a debate that was there, that because of the inefficiency of the state, because of the rampant corruption, because of inequitable distribution, we need to have this sort of reforms which will lead to establishment of water users associations, thereby which community of farmers will get control over the water, and they will be able to achieve these three different aims, that is equitable distribution of water, efficient management of canal, and resolving conflicts among the farmers. And in fact, resolving conflicts among the farmers was more emphasized in the act in itself in terms of justice giving to the tail ender farmers in terms of equitable distribution of water. My research site was located in I selected two water users associations located in Vaghat Dam, Vaghat Dam's command area, which is in Dindori Taluka in Maharashtra. The specific thing about this particular project is it is the only project in the state which is considered to be a successful project in terms of implementation of participatory irrigation management, and it is also been glorified by World Bank and state as well. Basically, my interest into this whole PhD project was because of this understanding of successful model and how does that actually mean in terms of achieving the balance between equitable and efficiency. Although I'm taking this opportunity to not debunk the idea of successful model or say corrupt, but rather I'm more interested in looking at how the alliances of power takes place within the local context in terms of farmers, bureaucracy and the NGOs. So let's come up to the first issue that I'm going to talk about, is the equitable and efficiency debate. Although most of it's not clear in this particular site that I'm looking at, Water Users Association, that there is the trade-off being done. What I will say rather is like a limited balance between the two being achieved by both water users associations that I have studied. And when I say limited balance, it is because in this particular area, there were certain farmers who were unable to get the water. Like access to water was prohibited. They were able to get the water, but the only issue was that there has to be a lot of hassle involved in terms of getting this water. So if you are a farmer coming from a middle class group, you are locating the middle patch of the command area and water is coming from the upper caste area, then you need to employ at least 2-3 members of a family. So that to ensure that the water is not get interrupted by the upper caste farmers. That was the kind of a problem these farmers used to face prior to reforms. Eventually, after the reforms, they told me like it has reduced a lot because now you have a secretary who takes care of that continuous flow of the water. So in that sense, one particular patch of farmers are satisfied with the reforms because now they get an access to reforms, access to water. Whereas on the other hand, you have other farmers, daily-ended farmers, who comes from a low caste background and whose lands are far away from the main canyon. In these particular areas, I find that there is still lacking that sort of access to water in terms of, despite the fact that there is a water user association. In fact, what I find really interesting is that when I talk with the farmers in these particular belts, that is low caste farmers belt, and ask them about the use of water users association, most of them was saying that they were more happy when there was a state taking care of the water, irrigation water, so that at least there were chances of getting it from the waterman in that particular area. And the interesting thing was, like they said, like even we could have actually corrupt in that sense to get the access to water, limited amount of. But with this particular system, where you have a village person as a secretary who is looking after the whole distribution process, that makes complicated for them to maintain their access. So in that way, the whole class dynamics goes into it. That's why there's a limited limited balance I think they have been able to achieve. The other interesting thing about efficiency is like the very idea of efficiency has been twisted by the Water Users Association. So when it comes to lower caste farmers, you will find the staff is more rigorous in terms of rotating the water, in terms of making sure that they are punctual, in terms of making sure they are regulated well, they use the water properly, they are prompt in terms of using the water. But when it comes when I asked them about this thing, they said like farmers need to learn to use the water, they need to learn the value of the water, the economic value of the water. But when one visit in the upstream areas, and there on the same water rotation, you will find all the water flowing along the roadside, getting accumulated in small ditches. And when I ask them, what is this now? And they said, no, this is not being less efficient. It is because we believe that overflowing water will eventually recharge the groundwater. So this is not wastage, but this is informed recharging of groundwater. So I think that is in itself is quite interesting, the way the efficiency been used by Water Users Association to defend their own interests. The other thing that is normally missed out in this equitable efficiency debate and I think that is what also we were talking since morning about what is public and private. And I think in this whole debate about public and private, we need to look into the modalities of functioning of any organization today, in what way they function. And I think if I apply the standards of private sector or private organization to this water user association, I find the water users associations are also functioning on a very same way the private organizations function. And one of the key feature of private organization functioning is of hire and fire labor or a contract labor, and which is very true in terms of water users associations. So prior to water users associations, there was this waterman which was employed by the government. So he was a class 4 government servant who has a fixed salary, security in that sense. But with the introduction of these particular reforms, the waterman has completely lost his value. So now these water user associations recruit waterman on a very temporary basis just for the sake of one particular rotation of 10 days, give him a minimal wage salary. There's completely no security given to them in terms of any violence that has been carried out in while the distribution of water, because there has been incidents of violence that farmers did on staff members. So that has completely been taken out. And this is not true only about the waterman in itself, but even the secretary, who is now occupies a key position in this water users association, is also open to this same sort of risk in terms of less income, monthly income, in terms of doing a lot of multiple activities. So a secretary of an organization does a lot of activities in terms of writing reports, conducting meetings, mobilizing people, also mobilizing people during the visits, because since it's a very famous project, people do play a lot of visits. There is an educational tourism or, sorry, not tourism, but educational visit or development. But development sector visit that they coordinate, and they do a lot of activities through that. So my basically the point that I want to make is like, you had one state-sponsored irrigation system, which was giving security to a lot of employees in there, working in there, and which was considered to be inefficient. Whereas now you have a system which is efficient in one way, but has taken up all the security sort of norms that was given for the labor. So I think that in itself needs to be revisited, the way we understand the failure or the way we understand the efficiency of public sector. Because the way public sectors were established in most of the developing countries, I think it was not just about efficiency concern only, but it was also about providing employment to a larger section of people. So I think in that way we need to revisit. Although what Shamik was pointing out, that we are not going to stress back the failure of the state. We are not going to study why the state really failed. But I think this is something important that we need to address whenever we are talking about this non-state actors sort of partnerships. The other issue apart from this efficiency is, despite the fact there have been equitable distribution, but what I also found is there are a lot of conflicts that still remain to be unresolved in these command areas of water user associations. And the nature of these conflicts is basically upper class farmers with a group of small farmers coming from low caste or middle caste or from a mixed migrated farmers. Similarly, farmers of middle class but upper caste farmers with a group of other farmers who are actually denying access to irrigation water by closing down the field channels passing through their field. And this is actually one of the cases where a farmer actually constructed his house, that is a farmhouse. The farmhouse is now in the concept of a big bungalow on a field channel. And in terms of legalities, the Water User Association have to issue an NOC before doing that. But that NOC was not issued. He promised a field channel to be constructed, but he never done that. And that there's a conflict between the farmers. The interesting part is that the farmers who are able to have relations with the staff, particularly the clerk, they're able to negotiate their access to water by finding one or the other mechanism. So in one particular case, what these farmers do, a group of farmers, they ask the secretary to give their share into some other farmer's well, and then they will be pumping out the water from that well to their farm. So this is sort of arrangement that farmers themselves make in case of conflicts between the WU. But in cases where farmers do not have any other solution, or they actually do not able to make that contact with the secretary or that arrangement negotiation, they come back to their groundwater. They come back to their well, and they completely denied irrigation water in terms of their crops cultivation. So in that way, it's excluding these farmers who are not able to build up this sort of social capital within the network of WUs. And the other interesting point about the whole idea of water reforms in Maharashtra is that in Maharashtra, we have already had a model where even a landless farmers were included in terms of distribution of water, because we understand irrigation as a very property-based system where only farmers with land are having access to water. We do not consider the issue of landless farmers. Although Maharashtra has this whole model of Pani Panchayat, where actually an effort was made to include the landless farmers in it, but most of them believe that reforms would have been that inclusive in that sense. But I believe that we completely lost this opportunity, and we once again, through these reforms, established the same regime of private property. access to water. Coming to the institutional aspect of the reforms, as a story of all the community organizations, it is also a story of reinforcing the existing social and economic differences among the farmers, and this is both in the process of formation as well as functioning. In fact, what is clearly seen is like the kind of paternalist relationship that the large farmers have with the small farmers. It's clearly exercised in this whole process of formation. So in one of the water user associations that I studied, the head of the founding member of this organization was used to work with the leadership of the village, and he eventually was supported. Then he found out this water user association, he became the chairman, and he held the position for a longer time, and he left the position as a chairman only when his son arrived on the stage and he became the water user association. And in this particular context, of Bagad, occupying this position of water user association chairman is important mileage in terms of your political career. So he became the chairman of water user association. Then he filed, since it's a reserve candidate, he made his nominee and make sure he gets elected as village head, and then eventually he himself gets elected as Jilla Parishad. So in that sense, you will find that entire hierarchy in terms of economy is get reinforced, the political mileage that has been taken up. So the kind of idea of participation or participation of marginalized is completely been negated since the formation of the organization in itself. The other interesting aspect about this organization is the complete absence of democratic elections. In fact, what is more interesting about this organization is that government in itself provides an incentive of ₹15,000 to this organization so that they do not conduct elections. So if you elect a leadership with consensus, then you will get a ₹15,000 as an incentive. So I asked the secretary that if someone comes to file a nomination, what do you actually do? And they say, we do a simple thing. We just ask him to keep ₹15,000 before he is filing the form.
On the table.
So it's quite interesting. And since even if a small farmer has a grudge against the leadership, he cannot afford to give 15,000. So it's completely marginalizing, the ordinary marginalizing this whole process of formation of committee. But apart from this, what I also want to point out is the dimension of justice that is missing out in this institutional aspect, and the whole debate of equitable and efficiency debate. That whatever equitable we are talking about is in terms of the distribution of the resource in itself, it's in terms of distribution of water in itself. But what is more important is in terms of justice, in terms of participation, of recognizing the diversity that we have in society. The kind of argument that Fraser talked about, recognition and representation sort of thing. I think that has in itself a lot of value in terms of participation of marginalized people, because I'm not sure how far it will making a difference in terms of larger decision-making process, because even though there is a reservation for women in the water users committee, I find that still their authority is being exercised by either their father, either their husband or their sons. But while I was interviewing one of the women member of this committee who comes from a scheduled tribe background, the interesting insight of this particular woman was that definitely she don't have any voice in terms of decision making. But what the participation in committee has changed is change her world view, in fact. Because being a member of the committee, now she can go to other places where the training of these workshops been carried out. So the training is carried out in Aurangabad city, where we have a water and land management institute. She has also went to Mumbai to attend the programs, because she is the only woman. And that is also something that needs to be understood, because being a woman from low caste is someone who is available in terms of taking away to different places. So I think because other two members, women comes from the upper caste, so I think they have their own restrictions. So they are not in that way sort of thing. But that was important for me to understand, that she said that for the first time it was a bigger exposure in coming out from a village understanding. Now she is in contact with these irrigation officers, she talks with them, and for her this whole experience of participation was entirely different was entirely in sense of changing her life, in sense of looking at the world in itself. So I think that the aspect of justice needs to be elaborated and needs to be understood not in terms of just equitable distribution of a particular resource, but also in terms of what that participation means, what that representation means. This is one thing that we need to understand. Then I will be just 5 minutes. So then finally, not finally, but I will be talking about NGOs, and a lot has been said about NGOs in terms of development literature. And here also I will again use this term limited resistance, because I'm definitely not going to say that the NGO that worked in this area is totally in support of the state and it's implementing the state. I think it is putting up a resistance in its own limitations. And we need to understand the kind of limitations the NGOs are facing in this particular. This particular NGO that worked in this area is basically a professional NGO consisting of ex-bureaucrats working in the education department. The only interesting part of this NGO, when I was doing the work, the spokesperson comes from a political background. So he used to be a trade union leader, and then eventually he became the head of, not head, but a spokesperson of this NGO who conducts the program. So he actually tried to maintain a balance between the two, and he actually make sure that farmers' voice be heard in the against the domination of the state or the education bureaucracy. And there's a quite lot of incidences that me myself has seen in the meetings where he was able to put a strong front against the bureaucracy. But although I think it's very limited, because this NGO then also depends upon other projects being assigned to them, because these are the only NGO which has implemented this water use project in this particular. So they are the only point now for the state. So in order to have that funding coordination, they might take a softer line at times. The famous line that he always used to tell me, I'm sorry to say, but he is no more with us now. He just died a year ago. And he used to tell me that the kind of philosophy we work on is like, tute paranta tanaichanai. So it means like, you should not stretch things apart till the time they break. So we make sure we don't do it. And I think when you have this sort of philosophy, there's some sort of compromise that is bound to be made. And that compromise is there. And it is also interesting, because most of the literature talks about NGOs being funding, reason, and sort of political, and they're being depoliticized. But what is missed is that some local NGOs, they are so embedded in the local relations that it also becomes difficult for them to challenge in that way. So for example, this particular NGO I'm working with, the spokesperson I was with, he is also a close friend of these particular farmers, and they had helped him out during his health crisis. So I think those all sorts of bindings comes together. So it's really hard to understand the way NGOs function. And finally, coming back to our own favorite, the role of the state, it is quite interesting for me, because during 2000, what we really had a debate about rollback and rollout neoliberalism, and we were really not sure what the state was more into it, what the role of the state is. It's withdrawing, then again pulling up in itself. But I think with the kind of work that we have in our hand today, like Foucault's biopolitics, which is a neoliberal governmentality, it talks about the way state is actually more active in all these reforms. And I see clearly that in particular water sector reform, the state has been more active. It is doing both the kind of regulating action in forms of passing these norms, laws like MMISF, and then there's the Maharashtra Water Regulatory Authority Act. At the same time, it is also doing the organization action on the ground. It mobilizing the people, it mobilizing the civil society to build up those things. So I think this is something that we need to revisit in terms of the role of the state, particularly in this sort of experiment. What really state is, and how do we understand it? And finally, this is just the conclusion, is that the kind of nexus that overall has been built in this particular sector, or NGO, state, and upper caste and upper class farmers, has been used to maintain that domination in this area. And this nexus has affected the accessibility of water to small and marginalized farmers in the area. And I'm ending this with some of reflections from my own research that I'm doing on what village forest committees in forest areas, as well as participatory groundwater management. I'm really sorry to say it, but we are not moving ahead in any sense. We are stuck with the same tragedy of community, as Pranjal has said, the power nexus thing. We are not getting into moving into further away. We are not have the institutions we design are somewhere again producing that same social and economic hierarchy. The only solution that's been discussed by a few people in the forest literature is about representation in form of reservation to these marginalized community. But I think we need to really chunk upon what really going to resolve this. Is it only the reservation, or do we need to do something more about it?